Hello, everyone. So we are approximately at 7 p.m. We're just waiting for a few more people to join us, and then we will start. Is my audio okay? Okay, I see nods. That's a good sign. Thank you. Before we begin, I just wanted to thank everybody for joining us today. Today is the 27th of May, and for all of us who follow the Thai forest tradition, we may know that today is the birthday of Tan Puttathat or Tan Buddhadasa. If he were still alive, he would be 116 today. So the BIA are organizing maybe a 3 to 5 day long event, most of it which is being held in Surathani in Chaya, where Suan Mok is. But we're really grateful that Ajahn Viradhammo, Ajahn Viradhammo has agreed to join us online so we can extend the celebration also to everyone online. Ajahn, may I request that you unmute so we could test your audio again? Oh, I will have to help you. There we go.
Right.
Krap, namaskar, Krap Ajahn.
Hello, everyone. Hi, Julie.
Krap, namaskar, Krap Ajahn. Let me see how to spotlight you because we're not spotlighting the people who speak. Oh, yes, we are. Okay, I think we're good now. So everyone, may I request everybody to pay respect to Ajahn by bowing 3 times, please. So first bow. Second bow. Third bow. Krap namaskar khap Ajahn.
Hi, Chui. How are you doing?
We're very well, thank you, Ajahn. And a lot of us at the BAA we're running around quite busily because we're organizing a lot of events in Chaya in Surathani these three, four days too.
Right. You know, Joey, because you're so frazzled, how about rather than just the Dhamma talk, we do some meditation first?
Krap Ajahn, we could
just
do that.
Just to cool the jitta a bit. When you've been running around, it's good to stop, huh?
Will you kindly lead us?
Yeah, happily. What would be a good time? Half an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours? How long would you like? I can do it all. Half an hour? Or is that too long for your program?
We've only requested for your time until 8:30 Bangkok time. So we don't want to eat in too much of your talk, Ajahn. So maybe 15 minutes, if that's all right with you.
Sure.
And then we'll agree to do the other remaining 15 minutes on our own after the talk.
No, you don't have to negotiate. Whatever your schedule allows. Okay, that sounds good. So maybe we do that first, and then you could ask for the Dhamma talk after. Does that work?
Yes,
right.
Please.
Okay. It's good to cool out. So please take a posture of meditation. And bring your attention to the way things are. Like, how do you feel where you're sitting, where you're standing? How does it feel to be there? Close your eyes. Listen to sound. Let the sounds come to you. Don't search for a sound. Just let the sounds come to you. Be aware of sound. And be aware of the silence that knows sound. Feel your body. Feel the breathing of the body. Let that become conscious. Know the body. And notice the silence of the knowing. No thought. Listen to sound. Let the sounds come to you. Sounds are in awareness. Notice the silence of the knowing. Feel the body and notice the silence of knowing. Be that knowing, knowing the way things are. So try to sustain that silent knowing. How do you do that? Now feel the breath. And then
recording in progress
for one in breath, silent knowing for one out breath. Be the silent knowing. You get kidnapped by thoughts. Return to the silent knowing. Listen to sound. Listen to thought. There's nothing to figure out, nothing to get, nothing to organize, just knowing the way things are. So silent knowing for one in-breath and silent knowing for one out-breath. How's that, Julie? Feel better?
Much better, thank you. did I look that frazzled?
Yes.
Thank you, Ajahn. And on behalf of the BAA, we'd like to welcome you to our Zoom talk tonight. Before we begin, during your talk, if I may, I would like you to maybe also mention about your experience with Than Buddhathat. I understand that you might have met him before. And have you also been to Chaya in Suratani?
I have. I can talk about that. It happened.
And after mentioning Ajahn Viradhammo, would also like to hear your views on the topic today, which is perfect me, the problem with becoming the me I want to be. It's got a nice rhyme to it.
Right. Joey, that's Joey's title.
So I'd not like to request for Dhamma Talk.
Please do, yeah.
Pramma ja loka tipati sahampati kat an chali anti warang aya jatha santi tha satta parachak cha chatika te se tu thammang anukam pitmang pachang.
Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Buddhang dhammam sangham sa. Good evening, everyone who is in Thailand and England. It would be afternoon and morning here. So hello to everyone. So we're gathered together to commemorate and remember the life of Mopa Buddhathat. And one of the beautiful things I've learned in Thailand is that when a great teacher has a birthday, people come together and meditate, reflect on the teaching. So this was my experience at Wat Pah Pong, where Lumpur Cha's birthday, and now Lumpur Liam's, and then still Lumpur Cha's, we come together, different monks, we give talks all night, we meditate, which was more a contemplation than a celebration. Obviously, we celebrate the life of these great Maha beings, but they're always pointing to us to do the work that they did. And so I'm grateful to BIA for inviting me on this occasion. I wouldn't have remembered it because Lumpur Buddhathat is not so strong in my sanya as Lumpur Cha. So I don't usually commemorate the days of his birth, but I think I'll put that in my calendar for the future. So Lumpur Buddhathat was a great influence on me through his literature. Heart of the Bow Tree, and I think Bodhisattva were the two books that influenced me the most. I visited Chaya twice, I think, if I remember correctly. One time was his birthday, oddly enough, and he was lecturing on dependent origination, Bodhisattva. And if I have it correctly, to make the whole celebration more simple, he suggested fasting. Because I think he felt that there's too much about food and not enough about Dharma on a birthday. So I thought, well, that's cool, isn't it? Yeah. So he fasted. And I think that was in somewhere 1980s, I think. But the talk was in Thai, it wasn't translated, so I had difficulty following it. But one of the beautiful aspects of Mopa Buddhathat that I remember is that he'd be giving these quite complex discourses from notes. I think he gave three or four that day. So it was a much more academic or scholarly presentation that I was used to from Lopa Cha. And this was more from notes, but through it, and again, I was having a lot of difficulty following the talk, but through it all, there'd be this deep, deep chuckle from Mopa Puttata. And Paticca Samuppada isn't particularly funny. It's not something that particularly funny about. And yet, you know, there's this kind of joy from Lumpur Puttata, and you know, say that's deep. And then you get on to Vedana and then something else. And so I remember him, his sort of, his person was very, he was very well within himself. You can see that. Just this great intellect, but also this great meditator. And that combination is not so common, I suppose, to have someone who was so academically or intellectually in tune with the texts, the translation. I think Lompa Puttadat started the Tamot Bla, the translated chanting that we used at Wat Pah Pong. Lompa Chan had no pictures of monks in his own kuti, except for Lompa Puttadat. That was the one picture he had. So they had obviously a very close affinity, but I don't think they ever met, if I'm correct on that. So that was one occasion. And just the impression, how impressive this man was, is the way his presence of his confidence and his joy in presenting something, again, which is can be rather dry and very intellectual, but he presented it in such a happy way. And then the second time I met him was really cool because this was not any great gathering. I was a very young monk. Again, I think that was probably in the 80s, maybe earlier. And I found him on the ground, sitting on a concrete bench. And he just had his Thai unks on with a bare shoulder. And underneath the bench was a German shepherd and walking around with chickens. And so I went up to him, I paid my respects, and I was very, very nervous. You know, I'm a young monk, and here's the great teacher, so I was quite nervous. And I was trying to ask very clever questions, which young monks do sometimes to me. Maybe I was trying to be clever by asking clever questions, but whatever the case, he wasn't interested. He was just very silent. And I just felt this mountain of silence, but it wasn't the silence which was rejecting me. It was, I think, kind of drawing me into his own silence. And that was impressive. That was very impressive. But then the kind of really cool part of the story was this big, big chicken hen jumped up on his thigh. So he's sitting there, cross-legged. Great, he's a great man. And this chicken is on his thigh. And I said, oh, what's this about? And then on his bare arm, I guess it was this arm, so the chicken must have been on the left side, on his thigh, and a mosquito is biting him on the right arm. So he takes the chicken over, and the chicken eats the mosquito. Which I thought, well, that's cool. Yeah. And then he looked at me and said, well, what do you think of that? Very kind of zen. I had no communication on that, but I thought, oh, yeah, I like this man. He's got style. But what, you know, the kind of bottom line is the deep, deep silence that someone like him, Lompa Chah had the same kind of deep silence where if you were able to get away from your own neurotic thinking, put that away and just be in the presence of Lompa Chah or Lompa Puttatat, you would have this energy from their side, this kind of rejuvenation of your own inner silence. And this was certainly true with Lompa Chah, where we just sit by at his kuti and just be there with him while he was receiving guests or he wasn't doing anything. And then you'd walk away very much fulfilled through that silence. So I, again, my time with Lompa Puttatat was brief, but I certainly felt that the affinity in that, my affinity to that. So the topic, again, Joey, do that for me.
Perfect me, the problem with becoming the me I want to be.
perfect me, the problem with coming to me. I want to be very poetic, isn't it? I think why Joey and I negotiated this talk last year, because he wanted me to speak about the teachings of Lumpur Puttatat, but I'm not well read in that way, where I thought I was proficient in that. So we decided on this one. And I think why we talked about this is because all of us who are gathered in this talk, we do want to be good people. And we already are good people by just being here. So there is something in us which aspires to goodness, which honors goodness. So when something comes up into our conscious experience which doesn't match that aspiration, anger, fear, self-doubt, worry, anxiety, all the different kinds of negativities that come up into the mind, that doesn't really match what I want to be. And if I don't understand Dharma and how things work, then I can very much try to become a perfect me and actually feel very frustrated. And I think we've all been there. You have this noble intention to free the mind, to be a good person, but then something comes up into consciousness which doesn't fit your ideal. So you have to go back to actually how does conditioning work, and how do we free the mind from those kinds of problematic habits? So, like, consider something simple like anger. Anger for me is different than hatred. Joey, how would you say in Thai, can you differentiate between anger and hatred?
Anger is glot, and then hatred is glot.
Okay, so you have a way of, you talk about that. So, for me, hatred is something which is very embedded in the mind through some past prejudices or whatever. And that's a different kind of work, really, hatred. But anger itself is quite a natural phenomenon. It's both biological. So if someone were threatening, if I was a grandfather and I had a grandchild and someone threatened my grandchild, I might get quite angry at them in a biological way to protect them. So that's just natural, isn't it? Just because we are, you know, we're incarnate in animal bodies, we have these animal impulses, anger and fear. There's nothing really wrong about them. Hatred is different. Hatred is when I've really invested in aversion and become someone who now has a grudge or cannot forgive or wants to hurt others. That's a larger, more toxic kind of problem. But it just, the arising of anger is both biological, but it's also historical. The reason I get angry in certain circumstances is because I have gotten angry in those circumstances in the past. So all of us will get angry in different ways at different times. So someone else will be angry about something and you won't be bothered. Well, don't make it a problem. But it is the way the mind gets conditioned. So first and foremost, we need to remember that the arising of these things are not so much personal, but Dharma. The arising of anger is Dharma. It's the Dharma of the way the mind has been conditioned. It's nature, it's natural. And the problem we have about being the perfect me, we have difficulty in accepting these kinds of things because we imagine the perfect me is one where there is no anger. Or we've read about it. We read about Lompalium, his enlightenment, where he, you know, his mind is free from anger. So you have to go back to the first noble truth and remember how that was presented. And it was presented that there is anger or there is suffering. It wasn't presented as I'm an angry person. Now that might not sound like much to you. That, you know, it's just maybe you think we're playing with words, but actually that statement, there is anger, is not about me. It's about the Dharma of anger. Sure, it's I have to have responsibility because it's in this conscious experience, yes. But when I say to myself, oh, and there I go, I'm angry again, or I'll never forgive her, or that's all what we call personality. But you can move away from that personality to see anger as an object. And that's the first step of seeing anger as dharma rather than a self. And that is so important. If you don't get that, you're always in Sakkaya Ditti, you're always in personality, you're always in avijja, you're always in this difficulty of being a person. The suggestion is the personality itself is something just comes and goes. But what doesn't come and go is the knowing. And that is the crux of liberation, to know anger as anger, as opposed to thinking that I have an anger problem, or blaming you on my anger, or blaming myself on an anger. And that is addressed through the First Noble Truth. There is suffering. Not that I am suffering, there is suffering. You have to recognize it, but also recognize it in an objective way rather than a subjective way. So all the different habits that we, and you can, anger is a very easy example, but self-doubt, fear, resentment, lack of forgiveness, greed, various kinds of things that we suffer from, they all have the same patterning in that they arise when they're stimulated by situations. The circumstantial circumstances create the possibility for them coming into the mind, and they're not really personal, they're individual. This is difficult to get across in Buddhism. There is individuality. Joey's experience right now is different than my experience right now. Bodily, mental, physical, environmental. Sure, there is individuality. And that's, individuality is the kind of situation that we learn from. I learned from the Viradhammo situation. Vibhun learns from the Vibhun situation. Michael and Zito learn from the Michael and Zito situation, right? This is what we call individuality. But individuality itself can be known. I can know that I'm getting angry in this moment and my friend isn't getting angry. So I can know that. I can be aware of that. Now, what is that about? Is that a personality? Is the knowing a personality? I would suggest no. It's not really. It's not like being charming or being shy or being aggressive or being passive or being interested or being, it's none of that. So the knowing itself is not a personality. It's wisdom. That's what wisdom is, knowing the way things are. So in the little meditation we did, I suggested, listen to sound. Someone's sound is on. We're getting some feedback, Joey. Great, okay, thank you. So I suggested listen to sound. And what is the end? But notice the silence, which knows sound. What is that? And then I say, feel the breath. But what is the silence that knows breath? Is it? It's always there. You just have to kind of remember it. And then I asked you to go between the two. And so I always do this in meditation. Listen to sound, but it's not about the sound. It's about the silent knowing. And then feel your body. It's not about the body. It's about the silent knowing. Because both of those, the conditions change. The sound changes, the body changes, but the silent knowing is always available if we remember that. Now that is the gateway to liberation from suffering. That silent knowing. So, what was the topic again, Joey?
The topic is perfect me, the problem with becoming the me I want to be.
Okay, the problem with becoming the me I want to be. Now, the silent knowing is not a becoming. It's not something you become later on. It's something you remember right now. And this is important because the Dhamma is akalika Dhamma. It's always here and now. So it's not like you accumulate a better ego. or get rid of some bits and pieces that you don't like. It's that you take your reference of your real home being the silent knowing. And once you get that, once you understand that principle in terms of very simple sense experience, then you try to apply. Well, first of all, you have to believe that or trust that. Does that make sense to you? If it doesn't make sense to you, you won't remember it because it doesn't make sense to you. So somehow there has to be the insight or the understanding or the acceptance that there is silent knowing, there is awareness, and that awareness is your refuge. Budang Sarangacham, Puru, the one who knows. It's like this, now is the knowing, and different ways that we talk about it in Theravada Buddhism and in other forms of spirituality. So if you get a taste for that, if you get a taste for that, what happens if you don't get a taste for that? Well, your mind will always be attached to conditions. So sometimes it will be happy and harmonious and you'll feel joyous. And sometimes it will be awful and you'll feel awful. So then you have no freedom. Every now and then it's nice. Every now and then it's neutral. Every now and then it's not nice. But you have no freedom. All you have is circumstance. So then what do? Well, you try to make your circumstances as good as possible. We all do that. But inevitably, it doesn't quite work. You get sick, or something happens you don't expect, or COVID comes, or et cetera, et cetera. So these conditions that we experience, although we do our very best to make them optimal, they are not a refuge. They're not a refuge. They can be fun. They can be interesting. We can share things. They can be ways that we are generous and so on, but they're not a refuge. So what is refuge? Refuge. Well, that's silent knowing. And I think we all know, that's not so far away. I think you all notice that. When I say, listen to this sound, listen. And in the listening, you're available to the silent knowing. Now, what's like, okay, so let's say you accept that suggestion or you've already experienced that. You kind of get it. Then what? Well, then the problem is remembering that. Remembering the silent knowing, what happens is you get kidnapped, your attention gets preoccupied with a lot of thought, and the thought is very much about personality. Why did they do that to me? I shouldn't have done that. What am I going to do if that happens? Maybe I'll make this, and then I'll do that. And the whole attention now is no longer the silent knowing, it's preoccupied with thinking. So then, if you're preoccupied with all these personality thoughts, you're not available to silent knowing. And you're just in samsara all the time. You're not available. So how do you make yourself more available? Well, you start to do exercises and meditation, and you begin to recognize there is presence. You just listen or you feel there's presence, there's knowing. And you start to get a love of that, or a faith in that, or an interest in that. As you understand that intellectually and emotionally, spiritually, then you start to apply that to the more difficult parts of the stream of consciousness. And the more difficult parts of the stream of consciousness are self-doubt or, as I was saying, anger. So let's say anger gets triggered by something which is justifiably anger-making. Someone really does something not nice to you. They disappoint you. Okay, so the anger comes up. That's its habit. Can you apply the silent knowing to the anger? Now, that's difficult. That's difficult. And so one of the ways that we talk about this, or that I've been talking about this recently, is can you feel anger but not be angry? You get that? Can you feel anger but not be angry? What's the difference? Well, the difference is a silent knowing. Because I can feel anger and then run with thought, it's not right, it's not fair, that's being angry. And the problem with me being the perfect me is that we don't want the anger. So we don't know how to feel anger and not be angry. We then try to get rid of the anger, which is called the vibhava tanha. But it does not work because vibhavatana, or getting rid of, is another kind of anger. It's an anger at yourself. It's guilt. It's self-disparagement. It's self-hatred, all that stuff. So that's not really liberating, because in stream of consciousness, you're not taking refuge in the silent knowing. You're taking refuge in thought and in personality. It doesn't work. But if you take refuge in silent knowing, you can feel anger, but not be angry, then you've got it. All right? So that's the second step, which is very difficult. same thing with other things. Self-doubt. Can you feel self-doubt and not be a self-doubter? That's more tricky, because self-doubt is just in thought. It doesn't have much emotional valence. Can you feel fear but not be fearful? Like, there's a difference between anger and hatred. There's a difference between fear and cowardice. Joey, how do you say in Thai the different fear as opposed to cowardice?
The nearest translation I can think of now, fear would be quam glua, and then cowardice would be quam kikat.
Okay. Where your personality becomes fearful to such an extent, paralyzes you, say. But can I feel fear but not become the fearful person? And then you apply it to worry, apply it to greed, lust, anything you want. The principle is the same. These things arise because of causes and conditions. They're natural. They're not right or wrong. They're historically conditioned from family, from culture, from relationships and all the rest of it. They come into consciousness. And if your refuge is in silent knowing, then you start to take on a challenge of what we call purification. Now, what happens if I feel anger but not be angry? What happens then? Well, the anger itself then is no longer fueled. Because what fuels anger, what makes the habit of anger stronger in the future, is thinking. Self-thinking, my thinking, ahankara, mimankara, I making, my making. That's the problem. It's not the anger. The anger is as it is, it arises. So here you get to the second noble truth, that the problem of suffering, this is suffering, the problem of suffering is not the anger. In this case, you could say, well, I got angry and I shouldn't get angry. Yeah, but in this case, as anger has arisen, anger is not the problem. It's the not wanting of the anger. And it's the attachment to craving. And this is what you have to be in as a contemplative. You have to really observe whether it's the fear, the self-doubt. There's something there that's there I don't want, or something else that I do want. It's the attachment to the wanting. And I mean, it's very natural not to want anger. Who wants anger? And who wants fear? They're unpleasant things. But that's the whole point of it, that life is pleasant and unpleasant. And the liberation from the pleasant and the unpleasant is not more pleasant. It's silent. So when you can then bring that silent knowing to anger, that doesn't mean you're going to feel nice. It still feels horrible. But now you are referencing the silent knowing rather than the anger. Then anger begins to fade away. And this is the idea of second and third noble truth. That the second noble truth is there's the attachment to tanha is the problem. The attachment to craving, not the anger. And if you know how to diagnose that and look at that, you say, well, wait, okay, anger's here. It's just the way it is. What is it? I don't want anger. And so I either blame you or blame myself. But then can I feel anger and not be angry? And that's a kind of wonderful thing, because when you really feel anger, you're really going into it now. You're not judging yourself for it. You're not blaming anyone. You're going right into it. What is anger like? What is it like as a feeling? Where is it in the body? And this is the path to liberation, because then the fuel of anger, which is the attachment to thought, attachment to self-view, that fuel begins to dissipate. There's no more fuel for it. And this is what we mean by the third noble truth, Nirodha or Nibbana. It's the cooling. It's the cooling of these fires of ignorance. And how does that take place? You don't fuel it. And what is fueling? You feel, but don't become that. So the very feeling of anger is hot, for certainly. The feeling of fear is difficult. The feeling of worry is difficult. The feeling of lust is powerful. But now we trust that awareness will take care of it rather than our own desire to be a certain kind of personality. And if you trust in that, then you will find that anger is not a permanent condition. It runs its course. Fear is not a permanent condition. It runs its course. These are just natural phenomena. But now you've got a confidence. You've got a confidence in the silent knowing rather than in the papancha of thought and personality. I should be this. I want to be this. And I think why Joey and I wanted to touch on this topic was because there is so much misunderstanding quite often in any spiritual culture is the idea that goodness implies that you always feel metta or something like that. You always feel compassionate. So you have a certain model that you attach to, an ideal, and then when you don't feel that, you think you have to do something about it. And you don't really kind of really go into it and look at it. So what is it really like? What is this really like? But if you do, it can't hurt you because it's not you. Your real home is the silent awareness. So I would suggest that, like, as you live your life, obviously all of us, I mean, we're serious practitioners. You know, this is serious work that we're doing. And to really look in your own mind at what is the difference between awakening and judging. You know, if I judge myself, like, judgment is fine, but when it's based upon guilt or self-disparagement, when I judge my emotions and, oh, that's, you know, if you're a dummy, you shouldn't be like that. That's not awareness. That's personality view. Now, just to follow my aversions or whatever, that's not the object either. But I don't think that's what we do here. Most of us, we get caught by things. We don't deliberately follow these things. But if you did, then you said, well, no, don't do that. That's not right. So most of us are in a place where we have enough integrity that we know to follow negativity is not a good idea. But a lot of us, and for me, over, you know, as I practiced, that was a big problem, was the trying to get rid of. So it wasn't the emotion. It was the trying to get rid of the emotion. And until I figured that out, I was always just in this fight and I'd never win. I'd never win because there is no winning in that. So to feel fear, but not to not be a fearful person, that's a whole different ballgame. You will have thoughts of fear or anger or lust or whatever, but just to really know it and go into it is then takes you to the third noble truth, Nirodha. So what is the path? The path is a path of remembering. You remember sila, right? You sustain some sense of presence, which is samadhi, over periods of time. In panya, you remember that your real home is silent knowing and that these things come and go. They come and go. Anicca, they change. So as you take refuge in silent knowing of change, you begin to incline to that which is unchanging, to the silence of the mind. And that's what I think I detected or sensed in Lumpur Cha or Lumpur Puttatat, this unchanging silence, this deep, deep mountains of silence, which was very energizing and not at all intimidating. So taste the silence of knowing with the sound of the air conditioner or whatever you got. You sit on a, you know, go to the, when you're going to the airport and you're sitting and waiting for your plane, rather than looking at your Facebook page or whatever you like to look at, just stop and listen and notice that there's a lot of noise in the airport, but the silence of knowing is always there. So with the noise, you have silence. Do that a lot. And then apply it when the emotions get stimulated, apply it to that. If you don't do these exercises in the simplicity of non-complexity, like sitting here is not a complex situation, I train the mind then in the sense of that presence. If I never do that, then usually the habits just overwhelm me. So you do have to train. This is what Lumpur Puttatat said, or the Buddha, or Lumpur Cha. And what is that training? That training is stopping, not being busy, not filling the mind with stuff, stopping, listening, and understanding what refuge means, knowing. It's like this, and then getting really good at that. And that's what your meditation should be about. If your meditation is about getting some altered state of consciousness, which is ethereal, what do you do in the airport? Then you think, I can't go to the airport because it just upsets me. No, if your meditation is about silent knowing, then that silent knowing should become more portable in all situations and all formats, right? So meditation isn't for me at least, it's not going to another state of mind foreign to the normal state of experience. It's rather coming to a state of mind which is available to all experience. And I train in that. If I train in that, then I go to the airport, or I'm in a business meeting, or I'm in a conflict with my family, I have more chance of being awake to, oh, conflict feels this way. Benyang, I feel conflict, but don't become conflicted. I know anxiety, but don't become anxious. So that's why we monks are always sort of pushing meditation on everyone. Because you know, like anything, if you're going to be a good athlete or a good craftsperson or a good accountant, you have to know how to do spreadsheets. One of our monks is very good at spreadsheets. I don't know how to do spreadsheets, so they don't let me on spreadsheets. But you can see it's all training in that way, and then you use that training. But so if you're making meditation something where you're going to get some ethereal state of mind, where you really feel blissed out and your mind is silent and you see devas and all of that, good luck. But if you make your meditation, I'm just going to sit for half an hour and be aware of the way things are. So even if you feel restless and your meditation is just totally basket case, fine. This is what it feels like to be a basket case. Or your meditation is very sleepy. Okay, I'll try to be aware of sleepiness. Because you're emphasizing the awareness rather than the experience. Doesn't matter the experience. So Lumpur Chans, you know that famous saying, if you want to meditate, meditate. If you don't want to meditate, meditate. Right? So, and that was the training a monk gets. It's like, how often did I want to meditate at Wat Pah Pong? Oftentimes I didn't, but that wasn't the point of it. So then I could watch. This is a feeling of not wanting to be here. Feels like this. And then this is a feeling of wanting to be here. Feels like this. Goes beyond wanting. Goes beyond preference. That's why a regular practice is so very, very important. And finally, I think a morning practice I would recommend. There's something about the morning, if you can get up before the world gets up, if you go to sleep early, and you start the day with this exercise of awakening, and there's more chance that as you live the complexity of your life, that awakening factor is going to underlie the difficulties and problems that you have. If, however, you wake up and you're rushing around and, you know, you're making a sandwich and going to the subway or whatever you do, it's getting much more difficult because your mind is already scattered. It's already in an unmindful state. So on the occasion of Lompa Putatat's the celebration of his life, again, I'm grateful, Joey, for you inviting me here. And I hope these words are of some help. Amen.
Han tamayang tamakataya satukarang katamase satu 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 anumotami. Thank you, Ajahn, for that very comprehensive talk. You managed to fit a lot in, even the Four Noble Truths.
That's the basic, yeah.
So we'll now move to the Q&A part of the night, and we would like to give preference to people who are on Zoom, because you can ask the questions to Prajan directly. So just go to the reactions button on the bottom and raise your hand, And automatically the sequence of questions will be visible for us to see. While we're waiting for everybody to ask the questions, I'd like to take the opportunity to ask the first one, Ajahn. One benefit that we all get from your teachings is techniques. And one technique that you often talk about is being a step ahead of the thought. You have ways of questioning the thought. Who's thinking? Who's thinking? You have ways of naming the thought. The name that you recently gave it is George. George, you're back. George, hello. Can you talk a little bit about techniques and how they're useful in the practice?
So Joey's reference to George was a character in his head who comes, and was it a critic? Or what was George? George is like your... So the problem is a voice starts to come through your head saying, you shouldn't be like this and you shouldn't be like that, no good. And Joey's asking, so well, what do I do about it? I just name him, but call him George. So, hello, George. And what happens when you do that? You become objective. When you are George, so it's kind of going referencing that again, feeling George, but not being George in this case. So the voice comes up, let's say someone has had a really unfortunate childhood, and that they suffer a lot from guilt because their parents were unkind to them and school was unkind to them. And sort of how do you say guilt in Thai? Is that a big thing in Thailand?
Not so big. Kwam rusuk pit. But generally I feel it's more of a Western phenomenon.
Well, how about self-disparagement? How would you say that in Thai? Self-criticism, self-judgment.
การดูถูกตัวเองการรู้สึกความรู้สึกต่ำต้อย we have a bit of that. We have a bit of that. But
well, what's again, the strongest thing you have in Thai culture? Which one? What should we call George?
You mean in which instances does George come up the most? Frequent?
What kind of George has come up strongly in Thai society?
Good question. I would say responsibilities. You have to do because our families are so close-knitted. We feel like we have to be there for the parents as well as the children and the family.
So it's a sense of duty?
Probably, yes.
A sense of duty, which can be a good thing. But also can become very, very oppressive, right? So let's say it's that. You have this constant sense of duty and you're getting burnt out. I have to do this, I have to do that. And then as you get burnt, like this happens quite often in taking care of parents. You quite often one person in a family of several takes on the duty and other siblings think, well, he's doing that, or usually she's doing that. I don't need to do that. So the person having the sense of duty, taking care of the parent, then starts to feel resentment, right? So they have the sense of duty, they're doing it, which is a good thing, but then they feel, oh, I feel oppressed. Where is my brother? Where is my sister? Why is this happening? And you start to feel resentment of that. So that's a common cultural, social problem it has in any society. So first and foremost, you have to realize you have both a social life and a life of what I call stream of consciousness. So not only am I taking care of my parents and so on, I also have my reactions to them. I don't want to do this, but I have to do this, and why don't they help me? And if we're not aware of those inner reactions as objects, then we're just a victim. So I've met many people like that who have been caring for a parent and very, very good, but they really don't like their brother and sister because they haven't come to help. So they have this loving relationship to their parents because they're exhausted and they have an expectation of someone else helping. Then they hate their brother or they hate their sister or whatever. And first and foremost, in understanding freedom, you have to understand the patterns of your mind. If you don't understand the patterns of your mind, then you'll just be the victim to that. So you start to become objective to suffering. There is suffering. So that is the primary method, Joey, in terms of technique. It's that attitude of this is an object in awareness, this hatred I have for my brother, this resentment I have because my sister isn't helping. That is an object in awareness. That's the primary, I wouldn't even call it a technique. That's the primary attitude. Like, let's call it an attitude that you have to always remember. There is suffering. And if you do that a lot, then as it comes up, you know it. And then as you have that attitude of awareness, then you can start to look at the patterning. So you become investigate, Dhamma Vijaya, you investigate the pattern of suffering. Why is it that when my sister phones me, I want to strangle or I want to yell at her or whatever? Oh, I see. Yeah. With sister as condition, there is murderous impulse as a result. Something like that's an exaggeration. And you start to see those relationships, the triggers. So your awareness, in terms of technique, awareness has to be more and more constant. If you don't have a constant awareness, you tend to kind of you notice things, but you don't really see how attachment works, what letting go is, and how to be free. So then if I'm going to run with this example, so I'm taking care of my parents and brother and sister are not coming, I make that my meditation object, that my meditation project, so to say. That whole structure is where I'm going to learn to be free, rather than thinking that I'll be free when they come and help. I'll just probably get resentful of someone else. So then that attitude then is the attitude of personal responsibility. And if you don't have that, like we see that with people, don't we? They really believe that the brother and sister are total basket, you know, they should go to prison because they're not helping. And believing in that, of course, there's no freedom in that. So you have an attitude. This is, why am I suffering here? What is it? Why can't I just be free here? And you question yourself, not through analysis, but through observation. So then you come to intention. Intention is very important because intention deliberately made is what helps you to awaken to habit. Intention deliberately done helps you to awaken to habit. In other words, I make the intention that next time my sister or brother phone, I'm going to notice the reaction. So the phone rings. I pick up the phone. People don't use phone. I guess they use Skype now. But anyway, you have the phone. You hear their voice, and now you've made an intention to notice the reaction. You're not saying, oh, I won't react. I'll be fine. You won't be fine because the condition is there, you know. So now I make an intention to notice the reaction rather than to be a different kind of a person. Now, pick up the phone, hear the voice, and the reaction is, why don't you help me? But you don't say anything. You notice the reaction, you bear the reaction, and then you start to break up the habit because now you are the witness to the habit rather than believing in the habit. And then, and sometimes this, like, let's say you're taking care of a parent for a few years, it might take like 5 years to figure that out. You might understand it, but your sibling relationship, this is just an example, there are many examples, but the sibling relationship you have has been embedded in you for years. And so the reaction you have is deeper than your logical mind understands. So you might, while you're taking care of your parents, you might be working with this for years until you get better and better at it. But now you've got the attitude of awakening. You have the intention to understand. You're not blaming yourself. You're saying, oh, wow, this reaction is very strong. Okay, I'm going to be aware of it. I'm going to be aware of it. I'm going to be aware of it. And that awareness then takes care of things. The reaction comes, you don't attach to it. Reaction comes, you don't attach to it. Reaction comes, it dies away. And then you have a heart, which then is okay. it's okay with not being held and so on. And this is the difficulty of training the mind, even though you have some insight and understanding, the vipaka kamma of these habits is very powerful. So you have to, you have to bear witness for a long time. But if you understand that the difficulties you have are your ajahns. Like the first talk I gave at Wat Pah Pong, Lumpur Cha asked me to give a talk. I didn't know any Thai. So I gave the talk of Ajahn Yung, Ajahn Mosquito. Because I don't like mosquitoes. I don't know about you. We've got a lot of mosquitoes right now. And so they were my teachers, teaching me patience and non-aversion and so on. So if you look at these situations as your teachers, you say, well, this is a chance for me to find freedom in the most difficult circumstance. Then that's really wise. That's really wise. Rather than thinking, if this person wasn't here, I could be happy. No, that's not such a great, I mean, we do that as much as we can. But if it's there, then you take the opportunity. No, I'm going to find freedom within this. And Joey, those are the kind of attitudes of like taking on these things and awakening to them and then making intentions to investigate. So the who am I, like who's thinking, takes you to the silent knowing. A very powerful one. If your mind is worrying about something, who's worrying? The silent knowing. If your mind is fantasizing, who said that? The silent knowing. So you keep returning to that by breaking up thought patterns. Any questions on the floor, Joey?
Thank you, Abhijan. Yes, we've got one from Khun Som Si. She would like to know if you define perfect me as having a pure mind. How do you define the words pure? Perfect me.
The word having something is already problematic. When I ask you to listen to sound, and there's a silent knowing, am I the owner of that silent knowing? Or is there just silent knowing? Interesting question. To me, there's no owner, there is silent knowing. So it's not so much an ownership, but it's a confidence and a trust in the awakened mind. If that confidence and trust is sustained, then the defilements of greed, hatred, and delusion will fade away. So the Yom Somsri, yeah, in a way, but it's not something you own and get. It's something you remember that's always there. It's like space. You don't really own space. Space is always there, but you don't notice it because you notice the mosquitoes or the thoughts or so on. And consciousness or awareness is like space. Things arise and cease in the space of awareness. And as that is understood, I would say it's understanding, then the rest seems to take care of itself. So it's a combination of confidence, faith. I think it's the confidence in the end that is your, which is like it's sadha, which is now informed by understanding. And that means you're kind of in the stream of dharma rather than the stream of ego. So I give me that question again, please, from Yom Samsri.
The question is, how would you define perfect me? Does it mean a pure mind?
So I would never define a perfect me because that in itself is a problem. There is no perfect me. And so what, like, okay, take that, like listen to sound, you have the silent knowing. Is there any me in that? There's just silence. Presence. Now, how is me created? It's created through thought. Like, I listen to silent, there's a silent knowing. Oh, I've got it now, I understand. That's the sense of I coming up, that's the me. But if you don't think about it, and that's hard to do, you don't think about it, there is no sense of me or other, there just is suchness. There is just suchness, it's like that. And that's hard to take because we so much identify like personality view. But you have to kind of do the exercise and say, well, what is a perfect me? It doesn't make sense anymore. Because you see, me is something that comes and goes as habit, as cultural conditioning, all kinds of ways, and it's dependent on thought. When you let go of thought, where's the me? Can't find it. Can you think about it? Yeah, I need to go to the workshop to finish that work. That's me, that's time. So me is in time. And I wonder if I should, I must remember to send that email. Yeah, okay, yeah, I forgot to do that last night, yeah. So that's fine. So me is defined in time. I am someone born in time, living through time, dying in time. And that's when we use the concept of atta in that's when we use sila and dana. I have a responsibility. I have a certain age. I have a certain passport. I have a certain position. And I got to go see the dentist. And so on and so forth, these different things that we function from. And that's valid. So the sense of self is valid. There's nothing invalid about that. But is that the only thing that it is? And Buddhism would say, no. That's conventional reality. But underneath conventional reality, there is something deeper, more profound. And then you come to teachings on Paticca Samuppada, Anicca Dukkha Anatta, these kinds of teachings, which are saying there is suffering. And if you follow those teachings, then you get to the sense of, well, where's the me? So you have both. You have the me as social necessity, and then you have the silence where you can't really find the me. There's just silence. And you're trying to do both, but when you understand the silence of knowing, then the sense of a me comes up according to circumstance. And this is, if you read Lumpur Cha's biography from Ajahn Jayasaro, you'll see this lovely anecdote from Ajahn Amaro, where he is asked by Lumpur Liam or Lumpur Chu to go and tell Lumpur Cha something, that some guests are coming, something like that. Ajahn Amaro goes to Lumpur Cha's kuti. Lumpur Cha is just sitting there, eyes closed in silence. And Ajahn Amaro comes in very, very quietly, kneels down, and Lumpur Cha, he's just not there. He's there, but not there. Just this deep silence. So Ajahn Amaro then coughs, and then Lumpur Cha, his personality comes out from that silence. And that I find very, very interesting. The personality isn't necessarily just from habit. It can be from circumstance. So a personality of compassion can arise, or a personality of fierceness can arise. Lumpur Cha exhibited that beautifully. He could be very fierce, he could be very humorous, but you always felt there was a kind of silence behind that. So when we let go of greed, hatred, delusion, and self-views, and we enter into that silence of knowing, then personality will arise, but it'll arise according to Brahma Viharas, according to metta, to loving kindness, according to compassion, according to joy, according to peace. And that's natural. That's natural. That's not cultural or formulated by anything. We're just finishing the biography of Lumpur Cha, and we're in the section where he is traveling through England. And all of us were very interested to see how would Lumpur Cha adapt to a different culture. And because he had just lived in Isan, and now he was in London. Wow, you know, we were all kind of really curious. Okay, how will the master be in England? He was wonderful. And the anecdote we read yesterday was we're off somewhere, and we have to go take the underground, the tube, the metro, to some other situation. We didn't have a car, and so there's I think four monks and an undergarb, or three monks, and it's around rush hour. And all the Londoners are really rushing, going from here to there and here to there. The Lumpur Cha is just going really slow. And everyone's getting irritated, including us. Come on, Lumpur, we got to go, we got to go. And he says, what do you mean? We got lots of time. and just chui-chui, just walking through, no problem, gets on, and it's just beautiful. He's just completely himself in this. There was no fear, no aversion. So it's really, really lovely. So personality has its place. Lompa Cha's personality is different than Ajahn Lompa Liam's, or Lompa Man's, or Lompa Mahabua's, or Lompa Puttatat's. Their manifestation is different in different situations. But it's all coming from a place of emptiness rather than a place of necessity. So you look at someone who is very... Someone comes to you who they're very, very anxious. I'm very, very anxious. Their personality is coming from anxiety. Or some person who's very, very aggressive. Their personality is coming from aggression, not from metta, not from karuna, not from mudita, not from upekkha. But these great beings that we need, they're coming from that, from the Brahma Viharas, manifesting as need. But then they can be silent. They can do both. Okay.
Thank you, Kopachan. We have a question from Karen Tan. So I'd like to ask Karen to unmute and ask Ajahn the question.
Hi, Karen.
Hi, Lumpur. Thank you. I think you elaborated so beautifully the second half of that question. My question was following Joey's George, right? So basically, he's got his alter ego that talks to him. And this intuitive intelligence that you develop over time that we call knowing informs us of what is, you know, suffering, and to acknowledge suffering is an object rather than something that happens to me. What I wanted to know, and I think you actually answered that question early on, as to how that actually leads to the dispelling of fundamental ignorance of self. So I think that you mentioned that earlier on, where basically that knowledge begins to refine itself to the point in which the manifestation of silence becomes a portal into the Brahma Viharas, because I think that that creates the environment to manifest all these wonderful qualities. Is that correct, Lumpur?
Yeah, you could put it that way. So I would say your preference to ego thinking falls away. It still comes, but self-thinking, ego thinking, becomes less and less believable. I don't believe that. It comes up. George arises, you know, or Sally or whoever comes into consciousness, but that's less and less believed. And as that's not believed in, what is left is silence. And then you become available to the Brahma Viharas, because you're no longer preoccupied with the ego. Because what else would the heart do? If someone falls down, like let's say I'm walking on the street and I'm busy talking with George. and then someone falls down. I don't even notice them because I'm busy with George. But then I see, hi, George, okay, but maybe not now. And now I'm available because I'm in the present moment. When I see someone fall down, I go to them because that's compassion. It's natural. Or I'm busy talking with myself about some problem that's coming up, and there's a child there with a balloon who's really happy. I don't even notice the child because I'm busy talking with myself. I let go of that and I'm available because I'm present, and I see the child with the balloon. Oh, great, beautiful, mudita. So I participate in joy, I participate in compassion, which are very, very natural. I don't have to really push them in any way because they're the natural phenomena of free heart, adaptable to time and place. Yeah, so I would say, Karen, that is the way it should work.
Thank you, Lumpur. I thought that was, I was going to lower my hand, but I thought I'd just clarify a little bit more. Thank you so much.
Okay, lovely, yeah.
The next question, Kabachan, is from Shui Hua in Singapore. The question is, a thinking mind can cause problems, but yet it is necessary for daily living. Can Lumpur explain what is the difference between a thinking mind and a contemplating mind? How can we subdue our thinking mind?
So you have different kinds of thinking, and thinking is very important. If you can't think, you're going to be in trouble. So there's functional thinking, there's analytical thinking, there's neurotic thinking, there's obsessive thinking, and there's contemplative thinking. And you can probably think of all kinds of thinking that you could think. So functional thinking is obviously necessary. I have a, like we're building our sala right now. And the monk who is in charge of that, two monks in charge of that, they need to logically think through payment schedules and ordering the materials. So that's logical thinking. Great. Analytical thinking. I'm building a bed right now, a big oak bed for Ajahn Pavaro. And I have to figure out how to put the headboard to the frame. And I'm trying to figure out what kind of bolts I need to use. Analytical thinking. If I didn't have that, I couldn't do anything. So that's fine. But then there's thinking driven by worry, driven by anxiety, driven by anger, resentment, fear, memory, just memory. You might have watched a movie and your mind is just playing the movie over and over again. You go to a meeting, you have to make a presentation at the meeting. You have to think about the presentation. You're nervous. You give the presentation and then you walk away and you're replaying it. I should have said this, should have said that. I shouldn't have said this, I should have said that. That's neurotic thinking, right? Driven by fear, driven by anxiety, driven by self-view and so on and so forth. Contemplative thinking is interesting because what it does, it takes an idea as a entry point into your inner experience. So the statement, there is suffering, could be phrased, why am I suffering? Now that's a contemplative statement, which is, if you're using it correctly, doesn't ask you to analyze the problem of suffering. It says, why don't you observe? Well, just observe, what's the problem? And I often talk about this. This was the way I had to work with fear because I had a lot of fears, social anxieties, and I didn't understand that the problem wasn't the fear, it was my desire not to have the fear. I couldn't get that, I couldn't understand that. And there's a difference. The arising of fear is natural. The desire not to have the fear was actually the problem. So contemplative thinking, which Lumpur Samedo kept suggesting, said, well, just observe for a stream of time, how, you know, you are suffering here. You know, something going on. Why don't you observe and say, why do you suffer? What's the cause of suffering? So the question then doesn't lead to analysis, but quiet observation. So then as I observed, I saw, I could see it wasn't the fear itself. It was not wanting the fear. And as I saw that, how could I see that if I wasn't able just to observe it? And we do that all the time. If you're a bird watcher, you observe the behavior of birds and, I see. Or if, you know, whatever you do, if you're a gardener, you're observing, that plant, it has too much sun. I better put it over there. So that's not really analytical. It's just observant of nature, observant of the way things are. So that's contemplative thinking. So complying contemplative thinking now with neurotic thinking. Worry, resentment, what have you. Then you use contemplative thinking by, first of all, saying, well, what's the mood of these thought patterns that obsess me? And I'll see, maybe it's self-doubt. I'm no good. I'm not good enough. I'm not getting anywhere. And you see, that's a mood of the mind. So the contemplative thought takes you to something bigger than the storyline. The story, like, let's say something like resentment. You resent, you have a meeting and someone in the meeting made you look bad, embarrassed you in front of everyone, and humiliated you. Humiliation is very painful. You endure the meeting, you come away from it. Now you have the memory of humiliation. And then your mind picks up on that like that and you start thinking, that was unfair. I hate that person. Why didn't I do that? And your mind just runs with thinking. So that's driven by an experience of humiliation. Contemplative thinking then says, what's the mood? What's the mood that is driving this thought pattern? You say, it's resentment. Oh, resentment. So you say, I'm going to notice the arising of resentful thoughts. So now you're getting some distance. There isn't just the storyline of resentment. Now there's the objective knowing of resentment as an aramana, as an arom. In Thai, you say arom, correct? Arom. I can't say the tone.
Yes. No.
What's the tone?
It was that arom.
It was that. I got it. Yeah. Okay, finally. Which is aramana in Pali. So it's the mood of the mind. So you're stepping back from the storyline. It's not fair. That person's a creep. I'm never going to forgive them. That's the storyline. You step back. What's the arom? What's the aramana? Oh, resentment. Then contemplative thinking says, I'm going to notice the arising of resentment. What is it like? What is it like in the body? What's it like in thought? Now you're having awareness of neurotic thinking. Then the neurotic thinking can begin to dissipate because you're no longer feeding it with the storyline. So you have many kinds of thinking, and right thought in Buddhism is not no thought. So right thinking comes from right understanding. And right understanding is what? That which has a nature to begin has a nature to end. So you start to employ right thinking by saying, oh, this will change. So the resentment comes up, and then you put into that, yeah, this will change. It feels like this, this will change. And that's what we call anicca sanya, the perception of change, or right thinking. This will change. Or you want to then really hurt the person and you start to, you know, think about how you're going to hurt them in some way. You say, no, better not. Right thinking. Yeah, but I'm going to really hurt them. No, better not. Not a good idea. We all have that. So there's right thinking from samadhiti, right understanding leads to right thinking, leads to right intention. 9:33, Joey. Are they going to throw you out now, or how does that all work here?
There's two more questions, Kapa Chan. Up to you whether you.
Oh, I'm ready. Please, I'm all them. Charged up here.
Ajahn Buddhadasa should have more birthdays. Once per year is not enough.
Do one on your birthday.
The first question is from the subsequent question is from Kunrai Rat. She has a question about silent knowing. Can silent knowing exist and manifest in an agitated mind? Or if the silent knowing is strong, does it pale the agitation? Can they coexist? In parentheses, silent knowing and agitated mind. Thank you very much, Lopar.
Yom Rai Rai. I think it's we perceive like silent knowing as an experience in a line of other experiences, maybe, because that's the way our minds operate. But I would suggest that silent knowing is always available if we are not preoccupied. So certainly, if you have a very busy mind, your attention is no longer available to silent knowing. But that doesn't mean silent knowing is not a possibility. So silent knowing isn't the same as day or night. I can only notice the day in the daytime. I can only notice the night in the nighttime. But silent knowing is always available because it's really consciousness itself, awareness itself. So the problem is preoccupation. And so what we're trying to do is let go of preoccupation by doing these simple exercises in simple circumstances. As you get a sense, well, I can always, it's always possible, you get better at awakening to confused thought, irritated thought, highly emotional thought. But it still runs. It still runs, but you get more and more space. And getting that space is understanding what non-preoccupation is. So what we do with thinking is we get preoccupied with thinking by thinking more. So there's some pattern of thinking going on, and then being good meditators, we think why we, you know, we think that we shouldn't be thinking, and then we think why we're not thinking, and then we analyze thinking in order to get rid of thinking. So we just think. And at some point you realize it's not about analysis. And so our problem, I think in urban cultures, whether it's Thailand or England or Canada, is that we are highly trained for analysis in terms of business matters, in terms of engineering, in terms of computer programming. We're, you know, our minds, our intellects are really highly trained for analysis. And we solve problems through analysis. So then we think, I can apply thought to go beyond thought. Doesn't work. I can apply right thinking. Thought is like this, there's an emotion. But if I try to go beyond analysis by analyzing, forget it. You're just like a dog chasing a tail, spinning around, right? So somewhere in one's spiritual life, one realizes the limitations of thought. That thought has its place and analysis has its place. I think one of the things I suffered from in terms of thought was I thought that if I thought that I'd come to some concluding thought, which would be the end of thought. So I kept looking for the conclusion and it never happened because I just kept thinking. My dad used to say to me, like if I had my dad was a lawyer, so he was a really sharp thinker, and I never won any arguments with him. And I think one time I almost won an argument. He said to me, well, when you've read more, you will know more. And I get angry at him, didn't win the argument. And so the idea, if you have more information and more analysis, that you will solve the problem. But it's not that way because thought begets thought. So you have to use thought in the right vein. So at some point, you become more interested in no thought rather than thinking about thinking and analyzing. And I think we overanalyze. We overthink things in terms of trying to get a conclusion or trying to find a technique. Or we do that a lot. And just the simplicity, yeah, I just feel terrible. Terrible feels like this. Without having to analyze it, without having to fix it, without having to have an answer. Terrible feels like this. This is difficult because thought, and then we were talking about, Amar Siri and I were talking about that the other day, that thought take, like let's say a terrible feeling. A terrible feeling is terrible by definition, right? It's not nice. It just feels terrible. So what do you do to get away from the terrible feeling? You think. And, you know, you're thinking about whatever you want. It could be distracted thought, but it could be thinking about terrible feelings. But you're not with the terrible feeling. You're abstracted from it. And that gives you some relief because it's not terrible. It is terrible, but it's not. So to go to the terrible feeling itself before thought, before you proliferate on it, it's actually quite difficult. But if you go to and you feel the terrible feeling without being terrible, if you go to that, then it will cease. But tanha, vibhavatana, takes you to thinking. So you have to go back to this, like in this case, it feels like this, which takes a lot of endurance and patience and trust and awareness. And we were saying that I'm sure that also this applies to joy. When there's joy in your life and you start to think about it, you're no longer joyful. So you have like a lovely experience and, oh, let's take a selfie. Let's take a photo. You're lost in thought. But actually to know joy as joy, what does that do? It energizes the mind. It brings you back to the same silence. And this is the way that you have in Pali Buddhism, you have the Bahiya Sutta. In the seeing, there's just the seeing. In the hearing, there's just the hearing. You know that sutta? Sutta de Bahia. Krishnamurti used to teach this way. You know, he would ask people and they'd start to think about it. He said, no, sir, don't go to thinking. How does it feel? I don't do it. Amar Siri does a good Krishnamurti. I don't do such a good Krishnamurti. Anyway, so that's what I think, going back to the first part of my talk, like feeling angry but not being angry is actually quite difficult because the thinking takes you away from it. Okay.
Thank you, Kapajan. Last question, Kapajan, from Kim Atkinson. What is the distinction between attachment, which is something to discourage as detracting from a desirable state of mind, and having goals and pursuing them in order to live a positive life?
Good question. So I would say that goals can be the vehicle, part of the vehicle you travel. We all travel in vehicles. I'm in the monk vehicle. And Joey's in the Joey vehicle. Whatever you you have the business vehicle, or you have the family vehicle, or you have the IT person. We all have different vocations and social structures that we live in. And obviously the goals of those of living any kind of good life is somehow to make life well for myself and others, to earn enough money to not only put food on the table, but to help those who have less, or to develop my own intellectual skills, or to develop my manual and craft skills. So this is the vehicle that we travel in. So some people have an attunement to craft, some people have an attunement to business, some people have attunement to engineering and different ways. And I always have a goal, I think, to do it better. I do. There's something very uplifting about that. But then that becomes the meditation itself. So if I'm working on some woodwork now, and I just enjoy trying to do it well. That's my goal, to do it well. But then if I attach to that goal, I'll never be happy. But I use that kind of suggestion. Well, do it well, Viradhammo. Don't be sloppy. Be careful. Be mindful. Look at your mind and do the best you can. Then it becomes a really good exercise in mindfulness to do something well. If I have a goal that is oriented towards, like if I'm a lawyer or whatever, what is the goal there? To do my utmost for my clients, if I'm a lawyer. But then also to use the law practice in my clients to develop a good heart. So I notice I have a client who's really difficult, and basically I want to throw them over the bridge or something like that. And no, I use that difficult client to develop the heart, to become a better person. So the goal is not so important as the attitude within the goal. If you have an attitude, and the underlying goal of Buddhism is to be free from suffering. If I make materialism the goal, then I'll never be free. But that doesn't mean that I can't make materialism a part of my goal. So if I'm a business person and I have 10 employees and I think, no, I'll make a business and then 10 people will be able to work. Wonderful. You have, entrepreneurial skills giving people work. Or I'm into IT, so I'll do good program and so on. But then the whole focus is the heart, really. How do I become a better person within the vocation and situation I have? Then at the end of it, whether my material goals become materialized or not is secondary. I know I've done my best in my heart to do my work well, but also to be a good person in that. So like a monastery is a very ambitious project. I mean, really, it's a crazy kind of thing to be doing, build a monastery in Canada, where there, how many Buddhists do we have living nearby? Maybe 10. It's not like Bangkok, right? So it's a very ambitious project. Crazy, really, but why not? Give it a go. So if the goal was to have the perfect monastery, then I'd really suffer. But if the goal is just to do something good, save society, but develop my own heart within it, then that goal becomes a part of my dharma vehicle. So like Ajahn Chah would say, you never like to work with the person, with the monk you dislike. Why don't you work with a monk you dislike? Be with him, look at dislike, look at irritation, look at annoyance. So I discovered monastic life, that was the form. How do I live a good monastic life? Well, I try to be a good monk, but I take everything that comes within the format of monasticism, disappointments and so on. And so that's where I learn. That's a situation I learned from. if you're a lawyer or a business person. Now, having said all of that, I became a monk very young. So I think I paid taxes once in my life. I just ran away to the monastery as quick as possible. So I, you know, to really understand lay practice, quite often you need to talk to other lay people, people who are doing the work in the complexity of lay life. So goals, if they're egotistical, they'll destroy you. If you have no goals, that's not necessarily it either. Ambition's not wrong. Like I say, this project is very ambitious, but it's not about my ego, right? It's about something that can serve a larger society. Now, obviously, in the business world, sometimes these values are not there. The values are immoral. They are cutthroat. They're not kind. They're not generous. So it can be a real conflict of the heart. It can be a very real conflict. And obviously, there's no real answer to that. But you have to stay true to your heart, to your moral values, to your ethical values. Otherwise, the whole system will destroy you. So how do you stay true to what you consider the truth? Like for me, I went to university and I lasted 2 weeks, to be truthful. Within 2 weeks, I knew this isn't it. I didn't know what it was, but I knew this isn't it. So I kept kind of going to university, but not going and reading philosophy and all that. And then it took me from that time, it took me 7 years until I figured out, oh, this is it. I found my real home as a monk. So sometimes you if you don't have that spiritual quality, the worldly life is very, very sour. But once you have that spiritual quality of awareness, you can do good things in any vocation. It's very, very possible and needed. We need moral business people. We need kind engineers. We need compassionate IT workers. And we need mothers who are protected so they can take care of their kids and you know, the whole thing. All right.
Thank you, Kapachan.
Okay, Joey.
So before we pay respect to the Triple Gem, and before we bow to you, I'd like to ask about your sala, how that is coming along, and how we could get involved, either directly or through contributions.
Well, now you ask.
we didn't
it's
prepare
very exciting.
Beforehand.
It's very, very exciting, actually, because this project has been in the books for 5 years. 5 years we've been thinking and dreaming and so we just they just cleared a big area outside this building, and 2 days ago they poured the footings for the foundations, and day before yesterday we went to look at the timbers, because it's called a timber frame building, and so all the timbers are visible. They're Douglas fir, and they are massive timbers. So it's going to be very interesting project. And how could people help? Well, we're trying to get our website together. Are we getting there? Sort of. So we'll have, we get so much to do here, sometimes we can't get it all done. But that'll be up on the website. And then we have several people who are helping with fundraising. So Michael and Zita are here on this exchange, and they're from KL. And then we have William in Singapore, and then I think Vibon and maybe Yopung in Thailand. So there are contacts, but I suppose what's the best way people contact us on the website? So I guess the best way is just to contact us on the website, have a look at the website. Right, yeah. And we, you know, we got delayed by COVID. So we had an estimate pre-COVID, which was a certain amount. And then we got the real time estimates about 6 months ago, and it was double, 3 months ago. So then we had a heart attack. And then Michael and William and Zito and others said, no, go for it to help us get through. So it'll be tight, because things are very expensive here. But it's really, you know, what makes the monastery in the end is the meditation hall. And right now, our hall where we meditate can only hold 20 people, which isn't big. It's like your living room. So we use tents, like we have a tent up here now. But if you try to sit under the tent, mosquitoes eat you. And then in the winter, of course, a tent at minus 30 isn't a good idea. So we have kind of limitations of space. So this is a kind of really necessary part of the development of the monastery. As for the monks, we're well off. We have good facilities, so we're fine. So we're trying to create this for the larger community. And the thing about Ontario is that among the Asian folk, among the Sri Lankans, among the Thais, among the Burmese, the Bangladeshis, Indians, Cambodians, they understand what Sangha is. But among the Westerners, Sangha is an idea which isn't part of their culture. So Westerners, on the whole, in the beginning, after a while, they see it, but in the beginning, they tend to relate to a teacher. So it's the teacher that's important rather than the Sangha. But the problem with that is if you don't have a Sangha, where are your teachers going to come from? And where is the communal center? And where is the place of gathering and the place of refuge? And that takes quite a long time to, I think, get across in North American culture. It takes a while. So in that sense, we are, you know, very much dependent on Asia on making this happen. So our running costs are always there. We always make sure that they are done. They're sufficient from the people that live in Ontario. And then the larger, like, capital expenses have to come from abroad. And unfortunately, things, you know, they're just expensive compared to Thailand, labor, and so on. But I think we're in good shape. Yeah, I think we're very excited and it's sort of moving along nicely. But yeah, if you get in touch with a website, then that's one way you could do it. Does that make sense?
I've included the website and contact information in the chat. So if anybody would like to get in touch with Tisarana Monastery, they can just click onto the link. And I've also included the Facebook link to the BIA's English language events. So to keep abreast with our updates, please follow our page. Now I'd like to ask everybody to pay respect to the Triple Gems together.
Arahang
Samma Samputo Pakawa Putang Pakawantang Apiwatemi Sawakato Pakawata Tamo Tamang Namasami Supatipanno Pakawato Sawakasanko Sanghang Namami. Now I'd like to invite everybody to bow three times as a way to pay respect to Prajan. First bow. Second bow. And third bow. Again, thank you, Papajan, for sparing your time. We went over time, so if you want to bill us for the overtime, let us know.
Freebie. Monks only do freebies.
Thank you, Kapa Ajahn.
Okay, Joey, give my best to George.